Okay, good evening, everybody. We're just about at 9 o'clock now, which is close enough. That's 9 o'clock Melbourne time, I should say. 7 p.m. in New York EDT, and very, very late in the UK and Europe. And I apologize to anyone who has made it on the call from the UK and Europe. If you're here, you're an absolute rock star for staying up so late. It's incredibly difficult to balance Australia and all the Southern Hemisphere with the UK and Europe and America. There's just not a time that works for everybody. So thanks to everyone who's been a bit of a trooper and stayed up late for this. And welcome to all of you from all over the world. I've been looking forward to this session all week. This is the sort of thing that I love doing the most. It's what makes me feel so privileged to be in this position, to have this as my job, as my world, as my life, and just the opportunity to help so many people and coach so many people and help you get to your health goals. That's what it's all about. So if you've been on one of my webinars before, you'll know the kind of drill. This one's a little bit different because today it's all just about you and your questions. This is my unlimited time Alkaline Diet Q&A session. I've never done something quite so, unscheduled and unplanned in terms of, who knows, we could be here for an hour, 2 hours, 3 hours. I can tell by the wad of paper in my hand, you can probably hear that it's definitely going to be more than 1 hour, let's put it that way. And I just thanks so much to all of you who've sent your questions in already, early doors. Brilliant work. It took us a while to collate them all, and a special thank you to Simon in my team who had the honourable job of collating them all together. And thanks, yeah, to all of you that have showed up, because I know you've got your busy lives. I know that there's a million things going on, and I know that carving out the time to do something like this, ultimately, it's something I hope and I'm sure and I know is going to benefit all of you heaps. If you've submitted a question, you're going to get an answer to that question. If you haven't submitted a question and you're here just to learn, my hat goes off to you, because to be honest, my belief is that I often, when I'm at seminars, if I'm on webinars, if I'm at live events, I learn so much from other people's questions, because they ask the things that I need to know but I would never have thought to ask, or it fires off something else in my head that I can apply to my life in another way. If any of you have ever been to a Tony Robbins event, especially Date with Destiny, you know exactly what I'm talking about. Those moments when he gets someone in the room to stand up and talk about something that they're trying to change or some challenge that they're having, and you think, oh yeah, this is quite interesting. And then he holds them there for like 2 hours. And over that time, your mind is just blown by how much you've learned from just the perspective from someone else's situation, someone else's question. So brilliant for getting on the call. If you've got a question, let's see if I remember my own slides. Here we go. I do. So if you've got a question that you haven't asked by email and you want to ask that question, you can type it into the chat box now. Nobody else will see that question. Nobody else will see who you are. It's totally anonymous to the rest of the world. Only I will see the question. If you've already asked by email, please don't ask in the chat box as well. I've got your question here. It's on the paper. It's in my big wad of paper here, so you don't need to ask again. It's going to get pretty confusing for me if you ask more than once. If you want to actually see if we can get you on the line and talk, just write talk at the end of your question or at the beginning of your question. It will just make it clear to me that we're going to try and unmute you and get you on the line. And just for your peace of mind, you're muted. Nobody can hear what's going on at your end unless I unmute you. So that's kind of the logistics side of asking the questions. The other side of asking the questions is that the questions have to be about the alkaline diet, getting alkaline, alkaline water, all these type of things to do with getting healthy, getting to your health goals. If it's customer support, forget about it. I'm not going to answer those questions on the call. If it's something to do with, and this is really important, something to do with a specific medically diagnosed condition, then neither I nor any other online health person or anyone can answer that question for you legally. They just can't, and nor should they. If you've got a medically diagnosed condition, there's going to be all sorts of things that are very specific to you that only your physician and people that have got access to your records and tests that have been done, all those sorts of things, I could give you some general advice that would be contradicting your situation, and I just don't know about it. So it's not just me. You shouldn't be taking advice from anyone online. Only someone that's with you face to face, that knows your background, knows your history, has your medical records, has all your test results, all those sorts of things. So I just can't answer those questions, and I will just have to pretend they weren't asked. Legally, that's just the way it is. So that is the logistics. We'll basically be running for as long as it takes to answer the questions. And more people are joining on the call as I'm talking. Welcome to you all if you've just joined. I'll probably give that legal thing a couple of times during the call, just in case people join late. What we're going to do is answer a bunch of questions, have a few semi-regular toilet breaks and water breaks, because I've got 1, 2, 3, 4 beverages in front of me right now. I'm probably going to switch my webcam on in a minute so that you can see me and we can be a bit more connected, and you'll see me regularly sipping from a bevy of beverages. I've got Red Bush tea here, I've got a powdered green drink with ionized water, I've got a lemon water here, and I've got, if you saw my big Vitamix jug full of stuff at the beginning there, I've now got the finished product of that topped up a couple of times. That made much more than just one beverage. So let's see if we can get my webcam going. So if you bear with me for just a moment. We may as well just start getting cracking on into it. The very first question, I love it, is from someone called Ross, of course. And it's, what are your thoughts on spirulina? Is it beneficial and should it be added to my daily diet? Well, really, spirulina is a bit of a funny one because it divides opinion on the alkaline diet. A lot of people believe that because it is from an algae, all algae is acid forming. That's just its nature. It's kind of, it's a mold, it's a fungus. That's what it is. That's it in its nature. So it's kind of, there is no way that that could be alkaline because it is an algae in its very nature. There's another school of thought from certain supplement manufacturers, and I'm smiling as I say that. I'm not meaning to be seeming suspicious of them, but there's the other school of thought that the way they manufacture spirulina in their spirulina production facility means that it's not acid forming. Personally, my belief is that there's so many really, really strong alkaline forming foods and supplements out there that it's just not worth taking the risk. I don't believe that spirulina, and the same for chlorella, I don't believe that spirulina or chlorella should necessarily have any additional benefit to them to things like wheatgrass and barley grass. There's potentially argument that they've got slightly more protein, but you're talking like a capsule this big or a scoop, you know, a teaspoon of it. So we're not sort of talking like protein shake proportions of protein. You know, if you're eating an alkaline diet and living in an alkaline way and getting a nice variety of whole natural foods, you're going to be getting plenty enough protein. And I'm sure that's going to be another question in here as well. So to just sort of keep this one brief, because it is quite a straightforward answer. Personally, I would swap the spirulina supplement for a wheatgrass supplement. It's as simple as that, and it's the same price, same benefit. It's just as much chlorophyll, it's just as much nutrients, it's just as much of all the good stuff, but you're not facing that risk of the algae being acidic. And the thing is that even if spirulina containing supplements are manufactured in that way, and I don't know, the jury's out for me, I couldn't say one way or another if that's definitely the case, then not all of them will be. And how will you know that yours is? You could ring them, and that's your prerogative. I guess I should move my little arrow off my face there. I'm not sure if you could actually see it. So there we go. That's my spirulina answer. So next up. Okay, Bill, you've sent me a couple of very racy questions. I'm gonna answer them broadly because some may be a bit too graphic for all people on this webinar. The slightly more in-depth answers may come via an email. But basically, there's there's a part of this that it's basically about libido, which is a good one to get into at this time of the morning. On a nice, actually nice sunny morning here in Melbourne. This is something that gets asked a lot, and it's something that probably would get asked a lot more if people weren't embarrassed about asking it. And I think it's something that affects a lot of people, and it is an acid problem. One of the hugest benefits that's so easy to get and happens so often, and happens so quickly with the alkaline approach to life. And just a heads up, when I talk about that alkaline diet, don't think of it as a diet. This is just a way of eating, a way of living. It's a lifestyle. We can get into more of that kind of stuff later, but I'll call it the alkaline diet because that's what we all know it as. But don't think of it as a diet. Don't think of it as like a diet plan that I'm going to go on for, you know, 3 weeks or whatever. But one of the biggest benefits with the alkaline diet is libido just goes bang. It just comes back and lifts. It doesn't turn you into like a, you know, sex crazed or anything like that. There's not over the top, but it does increase. And one of the main reasons for that is the suppression of libido is often largely caused by an overgrowth of candida and yeast throughout your digestive system and your colon and so on. So this question kind of answers the candida question as well. When you consume acidic substances, so things that contain a lot of yeast, obviously, things that contain a lot of sugar, especially refined sugars, things that are highly processed, this all combines to the overgrowth of yeast and bacteria and microform that clogs up your digestive system. So obviously consuming yeast does that. Drinking beer, which is, you know, yeast, does that. But sugar ferments and turns to yeast once it's in the digestive system. So when this all starts to clog up, there's a few things that happen. Firstly, the clogging of your digestive system. In the small intestine, there's all these little things called villi, these little fingers that kind of, they're the little things that extract all the nutrients from your food. So when your digestive system's clogged, these villi get squashed down, they get compacted in, and they can't do their job. So the first thing is the good food that you are eating in this instance, probably you're not extracting even 50% of the nutrients from it. But the second thing is it compounds. So the sugars and the yeasts ferment, they create acidic byproducts, the mycotoxins and exotoxins. These then feed the yeast and the candida and the bacteria and everything that are already there, which then creates more wastes, which then feeds more, and it just grows and grows and grows and grows. So when this happens, one of the biggest symptoms of this, apart from having yeast infections, candida problems, is a really, really like massive suppression of the libido. So the things that you can start to do, you can definitely try to cut yeast and cut down on sugar. I'm not a big believer in going from where I am today to 100% no sugar or 100% no meat or 100% no dairy on like day one. Like that to me generally leads to failure. I've been teaching this stuff and coaching this stuff for 9 years and 3 months. And the one thing I can say with absolute certainty is that striving for perfection leads to failure in probably about 98% of cases. Some people just, I don't know what happens. They've got this warrior mentality and they can do it, and that's fine and that's awesome. But for the vast majority of people, so like there's nearly 500 of you on this call. So for about 475 of you, or maybe more, terrible maths. At least I'm not trying to do it too early in the morning. I've probably got no excuse. But most of you, 98% of you, let's say, taking it slowly and day by day is going to lead to long-term results. And that's just the way I teach the alkaline diet. That's what you're going to get with me. So the things you can start to do is to cut down on the yeast, cut down on the sugar, cut down on the processed foods, but don't worry about eliminating entirely, because the thing that you want to do more is focus on getting the good stuff in. So focus on, firstly, you want to be focusing on alkaline hydration. So I know that there's a heap of you that will have my definitive guide to alkaline water already. If you haven't got that guide, don't worry. I'm going to be taking notes throughout this, things that I want to send you as I talk and as I answer questions. I'll be scribbling down on this piece of paper so that I remember to email you after. So if you haven't got the definitive guide to alkaline water, you'll be getting that after this. That will give you all of the different methods for making alkaline water, from the cheapest right through to the most expensive, from the easiest through to the most complex. It will tell you how to make the ionized water that I have in my wonderful drinks. Actually, I should put those back over there. But it will give you all the easy, quick things that you can do today. So that's step one. Step two is to start getting omega oils. Omega-3 is really important, super important. For people with low libido, for people with candida, omega-3 is so important. You can supplement with it. I personally suggest that everyone supplements with omega-3, because it's just really hard to get enough through diet alone every single day consistently. And I believe we need it consistently every single day. To thrive, to work optimally. It's for our cardiovascular system, for our skin, for our hair, nails, eyes, for our energy, for all manner of things, to keep our metabolism up, for weight loss, for muscle gain. It's really important. I'm rather bravely finally starting CrossFit today for the first time. I've been talking about it for a while. My buddies have been giving me grief for not starting it earlier, but I'll be starting CrossFit today, so I'll be having my omega oils every day without question. So the water, the omega oils, and then I also recommend just trying to get greens in. So you saw that picture before. I've got this, which I'll have a bit of now, which is just a really simple alkaline smoothie made from things like cucumber and spinach and lettuce and watercress. There's some ginger in there. Just those type of things, avocado. One of those a day. I'll tell you what, here's the simple answer for your libido. One of those a day, omega oils every day, and at least 2 to 3 liters of alkaline water every day, your libido is going to be flying. It's going to be fine in absolutely no time. And the same for candida. So I feel, Bill, I've covered your question pretty well there. Let's have another. There's someone here that I'm not going to mention your name, but actually I think I know who you are, and I don't think you would actually mind if I mention your name, and I'm sure we've talked about this sort of thing over in the past, but amen, I can vouch for the sex drive and the overgrowth of yeast and the alkaline diet helping both. Amen to that. Absolutely. Thank you for saying that. Are steel cut oats considered alkaline? This is a great question, because it sort of brings us on to the breakfast topic. So steel cut oats, that's a very American thing. We don't call them that over here. We just call them oats, I think. And but yeah, look, steel cut oats and oats in general, they're not like a super alkaline. They're not, but they're not super acidic either. And they're a really good breakfast that I recommend for people when you're first starting out, when you're transitioning, or to have just, you know, once a week, twice a week, when you are sort of in balance and living alkaline anyway, ongoing, because it's not super acidic. Does contain lots of fiber, does contain lots of protein, is nice and filling and satiating and great on a warm day. The best thing about oats for me is you can also add loads of cool alkaline stuff in there. So I actually quite like to cook quinoa, chia seeds I like to put in there, some flax, ground flax. There's a thing in Australia, I haven't seen it in America when I've been over, and I'm coming over to America again in a couple of weeks. I can't wait to get some lovely Scottsdale sunshine. But it's called LSA, and it's just linseed, sunflower seed, and almonds ground down together. It's like a almond meal. So put that in your oats. That's the beauty of oats. You can put loads of awesome alkaline cleansing stuff, like you can get some psyllium husks in there, some extra fiber, all that sort of stuff. When you're cooking oats, cook them in water. That's my secret trick, because, well, that's not a secret trick, but the secret trick is you can then just add a little bit of milk, like obviously I'm talking soy milk, almond milk, rice milk, whatever your non-dairy milk is. My actual personal favorite with oats is coconut cream or coconut milk. But you only need to add a little bit at the end, and it's as if you've cooked it in that. It makes it really creamy and really delicious. You can add some coconut yogurt to it, or some soy yogurt if you're a fan of the soy kind of thing. And it's just delicious, absolutely delicious, and it will keep you going for absolutely ages. Some people love to add fruit, obviously, to their oats. I'm not a big fruit eater. We're definitely going to get onto fruit in a few questions. I can see it right here, the question on fruit. God, there's some amazing questions in here. I can't wait to actually get some. So yes, steel cut oats, moderately alkaline if you have them with the right stuff, if you cook them in the right way with the water, with just the coconut or the almond milk or whatever added at the end. And that's absolutely fine to have that while you're transitioning. And even then, every now and again, while you're, once you've transitioned and you're living alkaline. Okay. The webinar is being recorded. I hope, I pray, I have pressed record. It blooming better be. So if it hasn't, go to webinar, we're going to get an angry letter from me. So yes, the replay of it, cutting out all of the breaks and the intros at the beginning so it's a bit more concise, will be posted to all you guys, and I'll be putting it online so that you can skip through, watch it again. Okay, this is a great question from June. Could you inform us what constitutes a serving size for most fruits and veggies, especially greens? Visually, it looks different with every vegetable, of course, because it's kind of the. Let me just write down. I'm going to send you a guide on this. I've done a blog post on this before, but basically, it's somewhere between 70 to 85 grams of that food is what most government advice, like the five a day in the UK, I believe it is, the five plus two in Australia, which is five serves of veg and two fruit, which is a bit more in my liking. I think it's five a day in America as well and elsewhere. They mostly say between, I think, 65 to 85 in that region. My post, I think, was around 75. So, roughly speaking, it's like a big handful of spinach or five lettuce leaves. I've weighed these out, so I roughly know. It's a piece of cucumber that's about 2.5 inches long, about 2/3 of a capsicum, which is a pepper in England. I'll send you the post, but it's about that. So, for instance, this has got in it an avocado, a tomato, probably about 8 lettuce leaves, 2 big handfuls of spinach, a whole cucumber, and some ginger and some lemon and a few other little bits and pieces. But that made 2 of these. So this in itself has probably got about 5 serves of vegetables in it. So it's bloody good. And it's delicious. And it gives me a green moustache. So that's very quickly. I guess the answer to that one is, check out the blog post. I'll send it to you. It's got actual pictures of all the foods weighed out on my digital scales. So I'm going to go now to the questions from the paper, because there's loads of them. And I'm just going to start with the first one from Robert. Okay, this is all about testing your pH, this question. So I'm just going to read it quickly. I've bought the pH strips and my pH level is sometimes up 6.5, sometimes less. What do I have to eat to maintain the pH level for more than 6.5 always, at least during the day? If you do the urine test, is the alkalinity reflected that soon? What pH is determined if an individual is too acidic? Is the calculated average of all pH major organs? So is the pH we're measuring the average of all the pH of all the organs in the body, and how does someone accurately test their pH? So first things first, I'll send you all my pH testing guide. Basically, this is a great question because it highlights one of the biggest issues with getting alkaline, and that's people testing their pH but doing it inaccurately and then getting misleading results. So on one hand, if people are getting higher than results than are accurate, then they are like, oh, this is great. And they might take their foot off the gas a bit, or they might be doing acidic stuff that isn't actually working for their body, but they think it is. And on the other hand, if their readings are too low, they freak out and then they try and be perfect and then they give up, and that's no good either. Basically, the pH test is a long-term test. Like, we're talking at least a week, a month, and it's really a gauge of how things are progressing over time. So you're looking for a trend, a long-term upward trend. You want to be testing your pH in the morning before you've consumed anything. So the saliva pH test basically tests for pretty much what you've just done, what you've just eaten, what you've just consumed. And that's why you want to test it in the morning before you've eaten anything, because it gives you a true indication of where your saliva pH is after a fast of up to however long you sleep, let's say 8 hours. So a mistake a lot of people make is they test their pH just after they've eaten something, or just after they've had something alkaline, or even worse, just after they've cleaned your teeth, which will give you a pH of your saliva of like a gazillion because the fluoride in the toothpaste. The urine pH test is probably my favorite, more so than the saliva, because it's less reactive to what you've just been doing or what the body's just been doing. It's more a test of really what's going on inside. It's usually more acidic than the saliva test. So if you can get your saliva test up to around 7 long term and ongoing every day, then you're doing great. Your pH of your urine can be tend to be a little bit lower because your body's always expelling acids. So test you at the first urine of the morning. This is all in the guide. Really what you're looking to do is to test every day for at least a week or 2 weeks, and then 3 weeks and ongoing, to just because you want to see the movement. So don't be too fixated with, oh my god, my pH is 5.5. Like, just don't worry about that now. What you want to be seeing is an upward trend. So in a couple of weeks time, it's 5.7, 5.8. To begin with, when you're first getting alkaline, if you've come from a reasonably acidic kind of starting place, and then you're getting more alkaline, or you're starting to put more alkalinity into your body, you actually see a pH go down to begin with of urine, because your body is now going, hurrah, you're sending me all the tools I need to get rid of all the acids that are stored in my body and the toxins that have been stored in there for a while. So that can happen. The question of is the value that you read a calculated average of all the various pH values of the major organs of the body? No, it's not. I've never actually been asked that before. That's a good question. But no, it's not. It's basically a measure of your body's capacity to get acids out of your body in terms of the urine. And that's why, to begin with, it could be down slightly and then it will go up because and then level off. Because to begin with, your body is getting rid of acids. So there's more acids coming out of the body. But then once they're gone, it will start to come up because there's less acids coming out of the body because they're not going in and they're not having to be neutralized and expelled. And that's when it will level off and become that nice, consistent average. So I hope that does answer some of your questions there, Robert. The pH testing guide will be on the email as well. I'll probably send you two emails. One will have all of the guides that you can just pick through and download the ones you want. The other one will have the link to the replay of the video. And that's what I'll do. I'll do both. So you'll be able to just click on it and watch it on your screen, or you can download it. And I'll even put up an audio if you can download the audio as well. Okay, so that's that question done. Let's go back to the questions that have come in right now. I've ordered Doc Brox from you. Doc Brox is a pH miracle, Dr. Young's, one of his green drinks. That's not the end of the question, believe it or not. How many teaspoons do you use per drink? It says one scoop on the container. Plus, can I use that instead of fresh green drinks, or should I do both? Okay, so first question is, how many teaspoons? So the scoop in the tub is about a teaspoon. 3 to 5 grams, I think it is. So you can use more than one scoop per liter or cup or whatever. This is, and this is going to be risky because this lid sometimes leaks. Oh, just a little drop. This here is... this is actually Mega Greens, I think. Oh no, this might be Doc Brox. But that is 2 scoops, and this is about 800 or 900 mils or something. Sorry, just almost sneezing. So I like to double up. I like to put 2 scoops in. Firstly, it's double the hit, which is great. Secondly, I actually really like the taste of it. And that's delicious. So it tastes better to me when it's a bit stronger. I don't like it when my drinks taste too weak. And I find 1 scoop in a litre, it's just got that faint, slightly weak taste. So I like it to be nice and strong. So you can use more than 1 scoop. That's totally up to you. Of course, your tub will run out quicker, and so it won't be as cost as effective. And your 300 or 500 gram tub certainly won't last a whole month. If you're doubling up, it will last about 2.5 weeks. Can I use that instead of fresh green drinks, or should I do both? I mean, ideally you'd do both. I understand that not everyone has the time every day to do both, and that's just a fact of life. And that's why I love these bad boys so much, because they give you that safety net. You know, like I'll drink probably three of these a day, at least three liters of these a day. Two liters of greens at least. I'll have lemon water. This isn't typical. I don't just walk around at my desk with like four different beverages, but I know I'm going to be here for a really long time, so I've stocked up on liquids. And if you can do both, you're going to feel the difference. You really will. Like the difference in what this would make me feel versus this is unrecognizable. But the difference between having this or nothing, or this and just water, is unrecognizable. So it's kind of like, do both when you can, but definitely always have this as your safety net, because it, I mean, it's awesome. It tastes great and it's just full of so much goodness. So that's the answer to that question. All right, on to the next one. Ross, I haven't got the money for a full under sink ionizer at the moment. Just check out the guide that I'm gonna send you, because there's lots of alkaline water methods in there. Okay, so I'm hearing that you're seeing me a little bit frame by frame on the screen here. So I apologize for that. I have got fast internet here. I guess it's just a go-to webinars capability. Another one about the pH test, and another one about testing the pH of water. So testing the pH of water, you can't use the pH strips to test your water. Unfortunately, that's just not going to work properly, because it doesn't. It can only really measure the pH of saliva and urine. Because I'm no mad scientist, but it works off the enzymes, or you know, if you test tap water or bottled water or whatever else with pH strips, like okay, if you tested tap water and then got that same tap water and put a bunch of pH drops in it, the pH strip would not give you any real different reading. And in fact, in some times I get emails from people saying, oh, I tested my pH drops with the pH strip and it made my water more acidic. Yeah, it just doesn't work. To test the pH of liquids, you need like either a digital pH meter, and I'll maybe go and get mine during the break just to show you, or you can get little droplets that you just put a little bit of water in, like a little test tube, and put little droplets in. They're pretty cheap. You can probably get those on Amazon. You can get everything on Amazon. Okay. How do you feel about hemp seed protein being added to smoothies, Chris? Good question, Chris, because it opens up a whole protein powder question, which I know is actually, I can delete that one as well, because that's where it is. It's in there as well. I actually don't mind hemp protein powder. I don't mind it at all. That's what I use if I'm going to be using a protein powder, which, to be honest, after CrossFit sessions, I'm probably going to be using a bit of a protein shake. I'm probably going to make myself another one of these and put a bunch of hemp protein in this, along with some quinoa flakes and some other bits and pieces to make me a nice protein smoothie. You can actually also add stuff like silken tofu to these if you don't mind tofu. I'm pretty sure the whole soy tofu debate's gonna be in here somewhere. There's a brand called Sun Warrior that do raw and sprouted protein powders, organic raw sprouted protein powders, hemp and things like that. That's a great brand. That's who I use. Obviously, whey protein is dairy. It's just concentrated dairy in a scoop. So that's going to be acid forming. The other proteins, there's soy protein, again, that debate. There's rice protein, pea protein. All of these are going to be better than using whey protein. Now, I know for gym fitness enthusiasts out there, they're going to point to the fact that pound for pound, the more whey protein-y kind of world of manufacturing drinks and powders and shakes and stuff probably get you more bang for your buck in terms of results. I think that's a short-term gain for a long-term negative, because if you're working out in the gym, doing resistance exercise or doing things like CrossFit, swinging your kettlebells and all that sort of stuff, I believe your protein
needs are higher, but I believe that protein is only one of the things that's going to build muscle in your body. And I believe that getting greens, getting oils are going to have just as much effect as the protein. That's not to say the protein's not important, but you can get a whole heap of protein from an alkaline diet. Absolutely. Let me send that to you. Because myself and Callum did actually devise just a day on the alkaline diet menu just to break down the nutritional content of the day, the nutritional profile of the day. And the protein, I think it was something like 80 to maybe more, I can't remember, but it was a whole heap of protein, plenty enough, put it that way. And if then, you know, if you were working out real hard, lifting a bunch of weight and you did need to supplement, the hemp protein powders are probably the where I'd go. Okay, let's have a look. I have a Vitamix and I've decided to start with one green smoothie a day. So I tried your seven most alkaline foods, spinach, kale, cucumber, broccoli, avocado, blah, 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 blah. It tasted like swamp water and I could not drink it. What is the best green smoothie to start with and how can we make it more tasty? This is something that I'm definitely gonna do a guide on soon, which is making green drinks, the juices and the green smoothies taste sensational. Okay, like this for me is almost that drink, and I think this is absolutely delicious. And I get emails from people that have bought my recipe books all the time that are just like, oh my god, the green smoothies are so delicious. But I also get people that are just like, oh my god, I can't drink that. So obviously some people have different tastes to others, and that's fine. And the thing is, the more you drink these, like, the more you're going to actually get to like them. The more you become alkaline, the more your taste buds will change. Sorry, very squeaky stool chair I'm sat on here. So let's just look at these foods. What I would do to begin with that, okay, so this is the seven most alkaline foods. Spinach, kale, cucumber, broccoli, avocado, celery, bell pepper. What I would eliminate from that to soften the taste is the kale and the broccoli, possibly the celery. If you're not a big celery fan, celery is quite a peppery kind of unique taste. So you don't have to put that in a smoothie. If you haven't got a Vitamix or comparable power of blender, you don't want to be putting celery in there anyway, because the fibers will get all caught up around the blades and it will taste very lumpy. With the Vitamix, you can throw anything in it and it comes out smooth as you like. But kale and broccoli especially is a very acquired taste when blended or juiced. So maybe take those out. The sort of things that you can put in to kind of to help with the taste a little bit is squeeze some lemon in after you finish. That really helps. Or lime. You can put in herbs are really good for making the taste much more palatable. Coriander and broccoli especially. I've just got, if I could turn my whole screen, I'd show you, I've just got the biggest parsley bush out there. It's just going wild. So I tend to just shove loads of parsley in as well, to be honest, and that really helps. There are a heap more things. You can ginger. If for those of you just starting out, and I'm saying this very, very tentatively, for those of you just starting out, you can put a pinch of stevia in there just to sweeten a little bit, a tiny bit, but try to transition away from that. Stevia's still bad. All sweeteners are bad. Stevia's still bad, but stevia's probably the best of the bad, best of the bunch. So you can do that as well. With same sort of things go for juices. You know, you could even increase the amount of bell pepper, capsicum in there to just sweeten it up a little bit. And if you have to, just water it down a little bit to just soften the taste until you're ready to have a bigger, thicker smoothie. With the juices, you can put coconut or almond milk in there to help, you know, make it a bit more nutty and stuff. You could even do that with the smoothie as well. There's heaps of things. There is a guide, a video guide coming on this very soon. I've literally got the most exciting, most amazing training for you guys coming up in the next probably 3 weeks towards the end of October. Honestly, you're gonna absolutely love it. I've only planned it out at this stage, but I'm already really excited about it. I think that my capacity for videos and delivering and what I'm trying and the message that I'm trying to deliver to you guys is getting just so much better. And you know, I think I've always been really helpful, but I think I'm really, nailing this stuff at the moment. So really look out for those guides that are coming up soon. Okay, there's quite a few questions about the Chansen and the alkaline water and the ionizers and stuff. So we'll probably get to those as a group. Let's just have a little look. There's so many questions. Is sea salt alkalizing or Himalayan rock salt? Yes, you can use sea salt and Himalayan rock salt. You don't want to be using sodium chloride, so you don't want to be just using table salt. That's no good. It's the same as going, the salt thing is similar to the fat thing. So going like table salt is the equivalent of like, you know, just a vegetable oil, canola oil or something like that. And then the Himalayan salt is the equivalent to omega-3. Like the Himalayan salt is actually good for you. You don't want to be like, you know, going crazy on it, but it's good for you. It's got full of alkaline minerals and you can use it and not feel bad. You don't have to restrict the Himalayan salt. The disclaimer on this is if you've got high blood pressure or some form of cardiovascular thing going on, talk to your nutritionist or your nutritionally aware physician before you change your relationship with salt. But even just switching from regular table salt to Himalayan salt is going to be a good thing there. What do you think about kombucha? Is this good for you? Very good, interesting question. Kombucha is a fermented food. Fermented foods are all acid forming. Bear with me, I'm going to switch to my Red Bush tea before it goes cold. Fermented foods are acid forming. So that goes for kombucha, kefir, soy sauce, miso, all those types of things. I hear the digestive probiotic argument, but there's other ways of getting those digestive goodies and probiotics into your body. Once you're balanced and alkaline, your digestive system is clean of all those acidic microforms and candidas and yeast and mycotoxins and all that sort of stuff from being overly acidic, you don't really need to be giving yourself too many more probiotics. Your digestive system at that stage will be working really well and it will be thriving and it will be looking after you. If you want to have some miso as part of a balanced diet, if you want to be having kombucha as part of a balanced diet, that's fine. Like, it's the same for apple cider vinegar. Is apple cider vinegar alkalizing or acid forming? It's acid forming, but it's fine in moderation. If you're using it just in like salad dressings, that's great. It tastes good. It has got some health benefits, but it is acid forming. But I just don't recommend using it as a supplement. In the same way, I don't recommend using fermented foods as a health food, like as a supplement that you're going to be consuming heaps of on a daily basis. Just see them as something, if you enjoy it and it's delicious to you, then have it every now and again, just as part of a balanced diet. But don't see it as something that's going to be a daily health product, because then you tend to overdo it. Okay, this is a good one. I just want to make sure I've deleted that one before I get into it. Yes, I have. Okay, this is a good one. Hello. You use you're a masseur working at Anytime Fitness in Moorabbin. That's just down the road from me. You're just down the road in Victoria, Australia. Good morning then to you. Do you have a view about using an alkaline cream on muscles and how do you think it may reduce muscle soreness? That's a really interesting question. So he's saying that I use wheatgrass super balm to massage sore muscles and joints. I'm getting good results from my clients and they're saying that they no longer have stiffness and soreness in their muscles. Look, I see it as a good thing. If you're using a really pure product that's actually got a decent content of the whatever it is in there, like the wheatgrass, because you know, you get a lot of these cheaper products that, you know, it's so, the nutraceutical world is so massive now. You get a lot of products now selling themselves on the back of, you know, containing wheatgrass or containing all this oat stuff and honey and all this. And you look at the back and it's like 0.1% wheatgrass. So if you're using a product that actually is high in the thing that you're talking about, I think that's great. And there's no harm in getting the goodness from the outside in as well as the inside out. The two things that I've found that have had the biggest impact on muscle soreness, not just for me, but there's a heap of people that I know all over the world that are strength coaches and conditioning coaches and personal trainers that have moved over to the alkaline world and that are now teaching that to their clients. There's two things. One is the ionized water, so the nice, strong, alkaline ionized water. Another is the using the four salts, so the Dr. Young's alkaline mineral salts. People just get amazing results with that in terms of muscle soreness post-exercise. The interesting thing that I've discovered recently from my quasi brother-in-law, Michael, in Brisbane, is magnesium spray. And I think that's a similar principle to what you're looking at here. So your question specifically being, do you have a view about using an alkaline cream on muscles and how do you think it may reduce muscle soreness? Obviously, the theory behind it is the lactic acid buildup, and you want to get rid of that lactic acid buildup. And so using something like a magnesium spray or a magnesium cream, or in your case, a wheatgrass cream, is actually getting alkalinity directly to the source there. That could be fuzzy logic. I'm not a physician or a physiologist or anything like that. I'm just saying what I've seen work for people in the real world. And using the magnesium spray works in the real world. The four salts definitely work because it's just like an instant injection of the most alkaline mineral salts direct into your body. So that's just like a supplement that you put in water and drink. And the ionized water, the same thing. It's just delivering alkalinity straight into you before, during, and after exercise, effectively. So at CrossFit today, I'll be taking that bottle full of alkaline pH 9.5 ionized water with me. And I'm pretty sure it's going to help a great deal. I'm expecting to be very sore after CrossFit. That's the nature of CrossFit. Okay, but good morning in Moorabbin. You're literally just down the road from me.